This week, right slap bang in the middle of the COP25 Global Climate Conference in Madrid in Spain, and the centenary meeting of the American Geophysical Union in San Francisco, a team of climate scientists has released a new study in the journal Nature showing that the Greenland ice sheet is now melting 7 times faster than it was back in 1992. And that report comes hard on the heels of a similar study back in June that revealed that Antarctica is losing 200 billion tonnes of ice a year, representing a 3-fold increase in the rate of loss compared to 2012. The Greenland ice sheet covers an area nearly 3 times the size of Texas, and together with Antarctica's ice sheet, it accounts for over 99% of the planet's fresh water. The report's findings are worse than climate scientists had previously been predicting, and because both bodies of ice sit on top of land masses and not on top of the sea, it means that as they melt down into the ocean, they're contributing to an accelerating rise in global sea levels. So is this yet another indication that we've reached a point where global climate change feedback loops are now out of our control? And if so, what consequences are we facing as a result? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Let's first of all establish where this new report is coming from exactly. It's by a group called IMBE, which stands for Ice Sheet Mass Balance Intercomparison Exercise. IMBE was established in 2011 in an attempt to reconcile satellite measurements of ice sheet mass balance, which in very basic terms is the net total of ice gained as a result of precipitation and ice lost through glacier flow and melting over the course of any given year. The research group is a collaboration between scientists supported by the European Space Agency and NASA, as well as other key Arctic observers like the Danish Meteorological Institute. The study compared and combined 26 individual satellite measurements of changes in volume, flow, and gravitational potential of Greenland's ice sheet to produce an agreed overall estimate of its mass balance. That balance was roughly neutral in the 1990s, but since then, annual losses have been rising, hitting a peak of around 335 billion tonnes per year in 2011. In total, Greenland lost about 3,800 billion tonnes of ice between 1992 and 2018, and the consequences of that have been a rise in sea levels of about 10.6 millimetres. Sounds almost negligible, doesn't it? Until you put some more tangible figures against it. Because for every 10 millimetres of sea level rise, as many as 6 million more people in the lowest lying regions of the planet are put at risk of having their homes and communities overwhelmed by flooding every year. Greenland's contribution to sea level rise is currently tracking in line with the IPCC's most pessimistic projection of the future. It's estimated roughly 1 billion people live less than 10 metres above current high tide lines, and about 250 million of those people are barely a metre above high tide. In an average year, Greenland sheds about 250 billion tonnes of ice, but this year has been exceptionally warm, with temperatures in the region where the Jakobshavn Glacier enters the ocean reaching the high 20s Celsius. As we covered in a previous video back in September, from July the 30th to August the 3rd, melting occurred across 90% of the continent's surface, losing 55 billion tonnes of ice into the sea in just 5 days. That's enough to cover the entire state of Florida in almost 5 inches of water. And on the 1st of August alone, Greenland lost 12.5 billion tonnes of ice, more than any day since records began back in 1950. According to Dr. Ruth Mottram, who's affiliated with the Danish Meteorological Institute, the ice loss this year was more like 370 billion tonnes. The IMBE Group's report on Antarctica earlier this year had already concluded that the IPCC were underestimating that continent's contribution to sea level rise by about 10 centimetres to the end of this century. Now they've concluded that the current prediction of Greenland's contribution is also under by about 7 centimetres, and that means on top of the 360 million people already categorised as being at high risk of annual flooding, another 40 million people now drop into that category, nudging the total at risk up to 400 million. Now, you'd be forgiven for thinking that the timing of this report might have been ideal for driving a bit more urgency into the negotiations that have been taking place over the past 2 weeks at COP25 in Madrid. But news from week two of the conference, when all of the so-called high-level meetings take place, has been absolutely dire. Negotiations to agree how to implement a robust and binding global carbon pricing system ended wearily and unsuccessfully in the early hours of Tuesday morning. A two-hour huddle of diplomats representing the US, the EU, Canada, Australia, Japan, small island states and Latin America culminated in a plea to the plenary chair to keep the meeting open and an EU delegate telling the meeting, "We cannot explain to the world why we haven't delivered on parts of the backbone of the Paris Agreement." Despite that desperate attempt, China, backed by India and African nations, demanded the meeting be closed without a decision. The visibly exhausted chair of the UN's technical body was left with little choice but to declare the meeting inconclusively over, stating, "I am perhaps more disappointed than in other meetings I have chaired." Late in the week, the decision was taken to keep the COP conference open for an extra 2 days to try and resolve these issues, and there was visible exasperation among delegates.
"We're here and we will fight. And the world is watching us, and I need to go home and look my children in the eye and say, we came out with an outcome that's going to ensure their future and the future of all of our children. Thank you."
At the time of publishing this video, there was still no news of a breakthrough. And efforts to convince all states to commit to carbon neutrality by 2050 also faltered. It's worth remembering that the commitments pledged as part of the Paris Agreement all fell woefully short of the UN target of keeping global temperature rises to 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. In fact, all the current plans of participating countries add up to a worldwide temperature increase of 3 degrees Celsius by 2100, and we're actually nowhere near meeting even those inadequate promises. So it was generally accepted that far more ambitious and improved nationally determined contributions, or NDCs, would be brought to the table by all nations in time for COP26 in Glasgow in 2020. 73 countries have committed to the 2050 carbon neutrality goal, but the big three emitters, China, the US and India, all declined to join the party. India said it wouldn't provide any updated nationally determined contributions for next year's COP and demanded that the whole discussion be pushed back until 2023, which is the year that the first global review is due to take place. China waded into the debate as well, saying that before asking all states to renew their NDCs, developed countries must first provide pledges on finance and governance. There's a big irony here, which is that because Mr. Trump has chosen to withdraw the United States from the Paris Accord, America's status in climate negotiations drops to the level of observer country only, and its ability to apply any influence over other nations in a climate context is reduced to more or less zero. So the current US president appears to have inadvertently given China and India free rein to determine their own future, and therefore the future of just about every other citizen on the planet. So while IPCC representatives put on a brave face for the outside world,
"If you cut emissions significantly, you really can limit the impacts from sea level rise.
So there is the chance to make a difference."
"There is a chance, yes. Don't give up hope."
The overwhelming scientific consensus is that our climate is changing rapidly right before our eyes, and if we tip over 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial atmospheric temperatures, we will head for truly catastrophic consequences. Those scientists have told us exactly what's causing the warming. They've also told us that we've now passed the point where we can halt the changes altogether, but that if we can reduce global greenhouse gas emissions by 7% every year from 2020 onwards, we still have a chance of slowing them down and staying within safe warming levels, which means we might be able to minimise the worst of the consequences. Given that greenhouse gas emissions are currently increasing by about 1.5 degrees Celsius every year, putting us on course for 4 or 5 degrees Celsius of warming by 2100, which really does represent existential crisis territory, not only for the human race, but for countless thousands of other species, then it's difficult not to conclude that we've got a real climate emergency on our hands right now. A global turnaround from a 1.5% annual increase to a 7% annual decrease in emissions can only happen with absolutely unanimous multilateral cooperation between nations. And that's pretty much the exact opposite of the global political environment that our leaders are currently creating across the entire planet. No doubt there'll be strong views on this subject, and as always, the comments section below is the place to leave your thoughts. I do try my best to read all the comments you folks leave, and where appropriate, I make it my business to acknowledge and reply to all reasonably argued opinion. But the number of comments often runs into the thousands, so please forgive me if I don't always manage to respond. Now, I must also give a shout out to some brand new supporters of the channel who've all pledged $10 or more a month at our Patreon page. They are Lisa Leonard, Doug Laughlin, Larry Helper, Trevor Walsh, Rob Anderson, Eric Lockhurst, and Chris Johnson. A huge thank you to those folks and to everyone else that joined the project on Patreon this week. You can also get involved in influencing the future direction of the channel with participation in monthly polls, as well as receiving exclusive content by visiting us at www.patreon.com/justhaveathink. No programme next week as I'll be away for a few days over Christmas, but we'll be back on the 29th of December with a review of what has proven to be a pretty momentous 2019. Please do give us a like and a share if you found the programme useful, and if you haven't already done so, please also consider subscribing to the channel to show your support and raise our profile with the YouTube search algorithms. Subscribing really does make a massive difference to the project, and it costs you absolutely nothing to do that. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching, have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you in a couple of weeks.